Part 3 of how we prepared for recruiting season. Replicate the interview environment and prepare your mind for it so that on the actual day, you're less nervous. I wrote down a list of interview questions I might be asked, then recorded my answers multiple times. Rewatching these helped me observe my weak spots. Try to practice at least 3 times with someone else before any interview. I found some designers in online communities and took turns being the interviewer and interviewee. This helped me get comfortable with strangers and learn from their communication techniques. Follow us for more design tips and advice.
What is up? Welcome to My Dream Job Journey, an event series from Adobe where we chat with special guests on how they achieved their dream careers. If we're just meeting, my name is Katrina Torrijos, and I am your host for today. And I am the Adobe Creative Cloud Express Evangelist, as well as a content creator on YouTube and on Twitch. So this is the 5th event in this series. So if you wanted to watch our past dream job events, check them out on the Creative Cloud LinkedIn page or the Adobe Creative Cloud Express YouTube channel to watch the replays. So shout out to everyone in chat with us. Where are y'all tuning in from? And also, if this isn't your first dream job journey event that you're attending, let me know how many you've been to, and have you been to all 5 of them, or have you been to just this one? Either way, welcome in, and it is going to be a great night. So shout out to everyone in chat. We have Michaela, hello. Amir, New Jersey. Brittany, Lisa Temple, hello. Hi, Courtney. Hi, Brian. Hi, Samantha. I see you all. Thank you all so much for being here. I love it. Okay. So today we are joined by Grace Ling and Kate Jung, 2 brilliant creatives who landed amazing roles in the UI UX and product design industries. Grace and Kate are also leaders of the Design Buddies, an amazing Discord community dedicated to bringing the design community together. And we'll be doing a Q&A session today. And they'll also be taking us behind the scenes on how they use Creative Cloud Express to create some really cool projects. Oh, cool. Checking in on chat. We have Jack from Seattle. Kimia, hello. Thomas from South Dakota. Oh my gosh, so many people here. Oh, we have a first timer. Bobak, hello. Welcome. Welcome to the stream. Awesome. Okay. So we also have some amazing Creative Cloud Express templates for y'all to try out and play with while we're doing this event. So if you post your project on LinkedIn, you may have a chance to randomly be selected for a one-on-one mentoring session with Kate and Grace. So stay tuned to the end for more details on how to participate in this giveaway. And I will also walk you through how to use the templates if you've never used Creative Cloud Express before. And also, as you can see on the screen, so many people in our community have already remixed this template, and you can feel free to just completely just work from the template or change it up, make it your own. Really, the possibilities are endless. You can do anything with these templates, but we'll get into that a little later after the stream. Oh, and also, we are having a Discord after party in the Creative Career Discord server where we will hang out after the event, and you can ask Kate and Grace more questions if we don't get to your question today. And it's just a nice, free-flowing, low-pressure just conversation between homies in a Discord server. So feel free to head on over there after the session is over. All right. So let's see, chat. Mao says, my first here because of Grace Ling. Grace, you got fans, but going to be for sure, or to sure join the future ones. This is a wonderful event by Adobe Creative Cloud. Oh, thank you so much. Awesome. We have RJ from San Francisco. Hello. Gosh, so many people in chat. Oh my goodness. All right. So Grace, Kate, are you two ready to answer some questions?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay. Yeah. Cool. So let's start off with the basics, just the introduction. So for those who are just meeting you in the chat, who are you? What do you do? And just tell us a little bit about yourself. We'll start with Grace.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me on. Super excited to be here. I'm Grace. Currently by day, I am product designer at Electronic Arts, where I work on marketing and event products. And by night, I'm the founder and design lead of Design Buddies, which is honestly a community that I just randomly started back in April of 2020, and it kind of went viral. Now we're the largest design community in the world. So it's super exciting. And for fun, I love to draw, make 3D art, run long distances, explore. And I actually came from design from unconventional path, which I can talk about later on. But I actually majored in bioengineering and computer science engineering in school. And now I'm here, just newly graduated in design, something completely different.
Nice, Kate.
Yeah. Also, I don't know where to look right now because I have like you open on my screen. So apologies if I'm looking somewhere else. But hi, everyone. My name is Kate. I'm an associate product designer at Spotify, and I'm based in Toronto. And I just graduated last summer from a graphic design program at OCAD University. In that way, I've kind of been in the design field like all the time, I guess. So I didn't really make the switch from graphic to product design until I've kind of graduated school. But outside of work, I host and help out at design community events sometimes, most notably at Design Buddies, who Grace here is a founder of. And then in my free time, I just like to consume a lot of content. I'm a big like TV show and book person. So I watch a lot of bad reality TV. I also really like true crime, which people think is kind of weird. But yeah, that's me. I'm really boring outside of work, I guess.
No, not boring at all. Okay. All right. So now that we know a little bit about yourselves or both of you, so how did you get started in your career journey in design? Whoever wants to start.
Yeah, I guess for me, I've always liked not being the same as others. Like for me, I thought normal was boring. And how that looked like in school is, so I grew up in the SFA area, and a lot of the kids here were like, I want to be a doctor, engineer, lawyer. And I was like, you know, I don't want to be the same. And I love like art, manga, games. So, and in school, I would actually never pay attention. So that was boring. And I just drew in class. I drew like manga, comics. I play a lot of MapleStory. Random fact, I'm max level on MapleStory, level 200. So I was obsessed with that game. That's actually how I got into community building, because I was a guild leader. I was this random 14-year-old girl leading a bunch of 20-plus-year-old dudes around. So it was really fun. And I loved manga, drawing. And yeah, I didn't have that many friends in school just because I was just like, I don't want to be mainstream. So I was never popular. I never did what normal people in school did at that age. And yeah, I also made a lot of online friends, then got really into art, design, DeviantArt days, Instagram days. And yeah, I kind of got my start in design from that. But in high school, I was actually running really avidly cross country and track, and got really into it, made it to nationals a few times. So it's a huge part of my life. And in college, that's why I studied bioengineering in college, because I was like low key influenced by like that doctor, engineer, lawyer vibe from what my society brought me. So I majored in bioengineering because I also wanted to learn how to biohack myself to run faster. Because I don't know, I just thought it was cool, got really into that, did a few internships in gene therapy and stem cell or cell research, and realized I was just doing it for my resume. I didn't really like it. My favorite part of it was actually taking photos of the cells and then overlaying them in Photoshop so they looked nice. And that was my favorite part. Like, I didn't enjoy anything else, but I love like the Photoshop part. And around the same time, this is like my junior year in college, there's like this virtual reality lab that opened up my school. And I was like, oh, this is cool. VR is so cool. Like, I can create 3D virtual worlds. So I started just like hanging out there and YouTube University-ing my 3D skills and game design skills. So I learned like Maya, Unreal, Unity, and just like made games, and which led to my internship. My first like tech internship was 2019, where I interned as a virtual reality robotic surgery game developer intern. That was my actual job title at Intuitive Surgical, where I made games to train surgeons to do surgery. So I've always loved like gamifying education. And I've also worked on a ton of projects relating gamifying education, because I've always thought school was kind of boring, and I like games a lot, and there's like a market for it. So I was like, product market fit, going to games and education. And then after doing a few months of just like coding and like mostly software engineering, I was like, I didn't really like vibe with it, just because I would get stuck on a problem and I would just couldn't see the outcome. So I realized I like the design part, the UX and the game level design part of VR game design. So that's how I discovered UI, UX, and product design. There was a lot of jobs in the market. So I just Googled, did some projects, really liked it. And then during COVID, I co-dammed one the director of my team at EA and got an internship and started full-time December 2020. So now I'm here in design. So
nice. All right, Kate?
Yeah, so my story is kind of weird, but I tell this to everybody who asks like how I got started in design. So back when I was 13, there was this website called Wattpad that was really popular. I don't know if you guys know of it, but basically it's this like online writing platform where anyone can come and read and write original stories. And it was most famously known for its fan fiction, or it still is because Wattpad's still going. But as a teenager, I was writing like really terrible fan fiction on this website like every day. And then eventually I kind of discovered this community of people that were making digital graphics for other writers. And that included like stuff like book covers, book trailers, banners, things that writers could attach as like a visual representation of their stories. And I thought that was super interesting. I really loved the way that the graphics kind of elevated the stories that I was reading. And so I taught myself to use Photoshop. And I think I may have designed like 100 One Direction Harry Styles covers, like really terrible, terrible graphics. And I realized that I really loved what I was doing. So that was the positive side, I guess. So when it kind of came time to choose a major to pursue in university, I naturally chose graphic design because I felt that it was closest to what I loved doing in my free time, I guess, even though it was a weird thing to do in my free time. And while I was studying graphic design, I discovered digital product design for the first time. And I was really drawn to the aspect of problem solving with my design rather than just visual communication of graphic design. So I slowly started to make the switch through like doing hackathons during school, some part-time jobs at startups to build up my product design portfolio. And then I officially kind of made that jump after I graduated when I got an internship at Spotify as a product design intern. And then I converted to full-time. So that's how I kind of got to this current job.
Wow, that is super cool. And we have so many people reacting in chat. Monica says, encouraging to hear Grace hasn't taken the traditional path. May said gamifying education is going to be huge. And then we have Megan saying, I'm hoping to find something in UI or in UX product design within the gaming industry. So cool. Katrina says, yes, Wattpad. Kavina says, Wattpad is still popular with teens. Everyone's just like, OMG, Wattpad. Everyone remembers that. Oh, man. Let's see. What else? Oh, that it, Noelle says, that is my dream job, Spotify. Yes. So glad y'all are here. Okay, so I'm going to pull the first question from chat, which, by the way, everyone in chat, feel free to drop any questions that you have for Grace and Kate at all throughout the stream, and then we will start to queue them up. We have moderators in chat looking over questions, and yeah, let's give some questions to Grace and Kate. So the first question comes from Mao. I'm curious, is it possible to talk about getting into internships if you're not currently in school or a recent grad? So how can someone get an internship now that if they're like well outside of school and stuff like that? Like, how can they get started?
So for me, I don't have personal experience interning when I wasn't a student. So all the internships that I've had, it's while I was still in school. And then after, in my last year of school, that's when I applied to the product design internship at Spotify. And because they accepted like graduating students, I was able to participate in that in the summer. So I don't have a personal like account on doing an internship outside of school. But I do know that there's some companies that offer like I think early stage design internships. So people who have graduated from school, they're not students, but they're looking to get their foot in the industry. But I don't personally have experience applying to those. So I don't know, Grace, if you've had any.
Yeah, I also haven't personally had an internship when I was not a student, but I have seen a lot of companies have like new grad roles. So I'll probably look into those like new grad entry level, just like search those. Because when I talk to hiring managers, I realize that they look for their hiring criteria is like pretty similar to interns. So would recommend looking for new grad entry level ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I totally agree with that. Like personally breaking into like social media and content creation, I didn't do any of that in college, didn't do any internships while I was a student. I was probably like a year or two out when I started pivoting my career. So I definitely align with what you said, Grace and Kate, to like look for entry level jobs, or even like there are some internships that don't even require college education or for you to be right out of college. Like there's definitely like programs out there for you, or even consider volunteering as well if you want to volunteer part-time just to get your foot in the door, getting some experience working towards the industry that you want to get into. You know, all experience counts, in my opinion. So cool. So let's see, more questions. There are so many questions all of a sudden that came in. So sorry if I miss it. Let's see. Oh my goodness. Okay. Sarah's asking, while we're on the topic of internships, Sarah asks, do you think that it's possible to skip the internship path? And is it possible to get a job right out of school?
Well, I actually came into my job through an internship, but mm-hmm. I can talk about how to get an internship or a job without applying. Yeah. that's what I did.
It's related. Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like these tips might apply to like getting your first job anywhere, whether it's like an intern or a full-time job. But to set the stage, this was like near the beginning of the pandemic. So this was like March, April of 2020. And I actually, it was like last summer of interning, and a lot of people were like, a lot of companies are canceling their internships. So I was on like some interviews and it all got canceled and stuff. So I was like low key or high key struggling. And I actually started like cold DMing people on LinkedIn. And well, how I did it was I sent 400 connection requests and had 30 something coffee chats. I can send my template in the chat as well for y'all to reference, but basically I framed it around just like getting to know other professionals. I know it's specifically message hiring managers, so senior managers, directors, managers, and I would just like look for those who have some similar commonalities with me and have a chat with them and just like get to know them. The mistake I made early on was I made it like really obvious that I was looking for a job, and it became kind of like inauthentic. So I would not encourage doing that. I would just like focus on just getting to know someone and like making a new friend. And sometimes I would ask like, what are you doing this summer? And I was like, no, nothing, no internship. And he was like, do you want to work for me or for this company? I was like, yeah. And yeah, so that's how it happened. So, but then again, it's a really big numbers game. Like I had a friend who did something similar and he sent like 2000 connection requests to get his job. And so the main thing is like, don't be discouraged if people don't respond. If they could just be busy, they could not check their LinkedIn. They could be not interested, which is okay. It just takes one yes to change your life basically. And so just like networking on LinkedIn, or nowadays, this is like before Design Buddies. Nowadays I've seen people like meet people in like other design communities or even the Adobe ACC server, just like meet people and then get to know them, and sometimes they might be hiring, and then you already like met each other in an organic setting, and just go from there as well. So that's how I basically bypassed the application process, because I sent so many applications that went to the void. Like I've never gotten success by submitting applications online, just because probably I'm not a design major. I don't know, but I got like zero successes. So all my jobs and stuff in college and internships are all through just like networking.
Nice. Anything to add, Kate?
Yeah, I think it's definitely possible to skip the internship path and go right into a job. I've met a lot of designers that have done that. And I think the most important thing, other than just like the education or internship path, sorry, not education, is the work that you have on your portfolio. So because the portfolio for a designer is the first thing that can get you through the door, you have to make sure that your case studies are really solid and they're really strong. So I think one thing that a lot of people ask me is if it's okay that they use spec work or they don't have projects that are actually a real life product or something that they worked on at a job or an internship. And that's completely okay. Sometimes fake projects are just as valuable as real life ones. So I would say don't wait for like projects to appear and just create your own. Start with looking for like existing problems that you can fix in some of your favorite products. You can attend hackathons and then create personal case studies from there outside of work or school, and then show how you're able to apply the skills that you've learned in UX or product to those projects. So you should still be applying kind of your technical knowledge to these personal projects as much as possible, even the fake ones. But if you are able to show that you are using them actively and you have the strong case study that outlines your skills, then it can help make up for the fact that you have less internship experience or work experience, whatever that could be. So that's my two cents for that.
Nice. Okay. So I have a lot of questions here asking about like, what are some tips that you have for someone who was looking to break into product design or let's say design in general? And a lot of them are also asking specifically about like what to include in your portfolios and stuff like that, or how to get noticed, or really just how to break in. So any tips that you have for all of our new designers out there?
Anyone can go. For me, I just did everything that I was interested in. And so that looked like me doing a bunch of Adobe Creative Jams, actually. I did like five of them in 2020. It was fun. It was a great experience because I got to kind of work with people. I would also like work with people I never worked with before, I don't know, because that helped me get collaboration skills that I can later talk about during my interviews. And also ideate and solve a problem together really quickly with design. And so I would just do a bunch of designathons. I think I did like, I forgot, I think I had 10 in 2020. And that helped me like really be quick at thinking and work really well, or like gain a lot of like teamwork skills. And the second thing is I actually volunteered at another company. Well, it was actually started by my friends in college, and got some experience like collaborating with like product managers, engineers, and just like making like this little mentorship app. And so I would just like try to find as much experience as I can to put stuff in my portfolio. And then another thing that I did, that one of the case studies that I actually showed during my internship interview, I actually still had an interview, so disclaimer, it was actually me taking an existing app and then researching and try to like design ways to improve it. And so it's on Discord and I can send it in a chat as well, but it was easy for me to take, especially when I was starting out, to take an existing app and trying to do some research on it and design it feature. And that was like really great project. Like a lot of hiring managers liked it. And that's the one I showed during my interviews. So I can show it in the chat. So I guess sum it up, like hack designathons, volunteer projects, and just like doing research on like an app you like and how to improve it.
Yes, plus one to that. For me, I would say like first form a really clear story about who you are, what your strengths are, and what your mission is as a product designer, and then really sit down, write down that story, and then practice it. One framework that I used to use was the T-shaped profile, which is basically the idea that designers have a depth of skill and experience in like one focus, which is a vertical line of the T. But then they have a breadth of skill across the other disciplines of design, which is the horizontal part of the T. So combined, those are the UX superpowers that you should definitely show off, whether that's in your portfolio or during interviews. And then after that, I guess anything that you can do to be active online, network with designers that you look up to, would definitely help you strengthen that personal brand or get you to take a first step into the industry. For me, I was a super introverted person. I still am now. So networking definitely didn't come that easily to me. So I would find like different ways to make more natural conversations with people. And one way that I did that was attending a lot of virtual design conferences and workshops. Like I remember in college, I used to RSVP to like every free design event that I could find on Eventbrite. And then I would send a follow-up connection to the speaker afterwards with a question or a response to something that they said, and then see if that would spark a conversation. And now that I'm actually speaking in some events myself, a lot of people are reaching out in that way, saying that they attended the event, they relate to this or that, and I'm happy to start a conversation with those kinds of people, because I think it starts a really natural conversation as well. And then also don't be shy about sharing your career goals with the people that you work with or people that you're close with, because you never know what kind of opportunities they might have that they could connect you with. There was one time where I was working as a graphic designer at a startup, and I expressed my interest in UX design to my manager, and he ended up referring me to his friend for my first like web/UX design job. So because he had like a clear idea of what I was looking for in my career, he was able to help me get started or take that first step. So yeah, that's a very long answer.
No, it's perfect. I love it. That's such a good tip to connect with like speakers and stuff after events. And I definitely think that we have some introverts in chat because we just have a question on that topic. Gianna, sorry if I pronounce your name wrong. Please correct me in the chat. Gianna Sherry asks, what advice would you share for introverts trying to overcome social anxiety and networking in design? Networking tips.
Yeah, I guess I partly answered that question. I'm still struggling with it myself, like being shy, meeting new people. So maybe I don't have an answer for that yet. But one thing would be to create like natural moments of conversation, like I said. And then the easiest way to, I think, start talking to people is through friends or people that you're comfortable with already. So if you know somebody who's in the design industry, or are close to somebody in the design industry, see if you can ask them to make a connection there. And then you could start speaking to somebody in a senior designer role that you can maybe learn from and become a mentee of. So yeah, that's my advice.
Nice. How about you, Grace?
Yeah, I love like meeting people organically. Like for me, I'm actually an introvert as well. I was actually super shy, and then like, I went to my, this is like really random, like really short aside, but I went to my first ever tech conference, Grace Hopper conference. I realized everyone was like all out there and getting the attention of recruiters. So I was like, okay, gotta like prepare myself and gotta practice. So by forcing myself to like talk to strangers every single day, it made me put out my comfort zone, realize that people are not scary. People are like usually really wholesome. I mean, there's some that are kind of sus, but like majority, I would say like 99.9% of people are like really nice. And that helped me like get over my fear of talking to people. And I like what Kate said, like meeting people in an organic setting, like through like communities on LinkedIn, commenting on their posts. So having like that connection with them. And another thing that I like to look at networking is making friends, because networking feels low-key, like at least to me, a little bit transactional. It's like, oh, I had to get something out of it. And it's like, it has a I feel like it put a lot of pressure on me. And so I would treat it as like making new friends in a professional world, like making new friends with professional interests in common as well. And then I guess the third tip I would give on like networking is I just like to like not take life too seriously. And that looks like if people don't like me, like that is okay. Because as a human, it's really easy for me at least to like focus on the few that are like not very wholesome, and it ruins the fun a little bit. And so I would just like, if someone doesn't vibe, then I would just like move on, because I used to be like really nervous when I like try to connect with someone, but they didn't like vibe. And so that would like turn me off, or like that would just like make me scared. But then I just realized, oh, just there's always like a lot of friendly people in the world. Just like focus on that. And that's what personally helped me get out of my comfort zone and meeting new people, like being not afraid of judgment.
Yeah. I just want to add one more thing, because Grace reminded me. I think we could kind of plug Design Buddies here, because Design Buddies was really helpful for me when I was really shy and I was trying to make friends in the design world. I joined the Discord server a couple years ago, I think. And at first I wasn't like saying anything. I was kind of nervous about meeting new people, But then seeing all the different like social channels and then joining in on the conversation little bits at a time kind of help ease into like making new friends. So and then most of the time, a lot of people in these communities, you can find people that are in similar positions as you. Like maybe you're really struggling with the interview process. There's usually a lot of people who are working towards that same goal as well. So I find that it's easy to make friends when you have a common goal and you're kind of in the same boat, I guess. And then another platform I would suggest is ADP List. I think somebody mentioned it in the comments actually, but ADP List is like a free mentorship community where you can get connected to like one-to-one mentoring sessions with a designer. And I found that really, really helpful because it's not as intimidating as just sending a connection request on LinkedIn and not knowing if they would respond. These mentors actively go on these platforms, this platform, offer their time, they're open to mentoring. So I think in that way, kind of ease my worry of like, am I bothering them? Like, oh no, what if they don't want to talk to me? They want to talk to you, that's why they're there. So I would recommend ADP List.
Love that. Okay, so while we're on the topic of like resources and places, you know, where folks can connect, I have a question here that came from two people, Samantha and Nicole, but how do you find design-a-thons? And like, let's just expand it out a little bit beyond design-a-thons, but also how do you find like conferences, meetups, events? Like, what are your go-to places to find places to connect?
I also just check the Design Buddies events channel. That's how I find out. It's people like shared in there. I also lurk in a lot of places. I also subscribe to a lot of newsletters. And sometimes I like look at them and see like other conferences and stuff. But yeah, mostly just gain it from Design Buddies and just like by talking to other people and also my coworkers too.
Yeah. Do you have any like events or things that you regularly go to that you would recommend for folks to check out?
I guess Design Buddies events. We have a lot of workshops. I'm trying to think. Kate, maybe you can also jump in on this one too.
Adobe Creative Jams. Grace, you and I both attended those. I met a ton of friends through Adobe Creative Jams. So that's one that I would recommend. And then I'm a huge like TikTok social media user. So I follow like a ton of design related creators. And sometimes in the comments, there's people like talking about the video that the creator posted. And then in that way, I can kind of like see this person's also a designer. Maybe I can slide into their DMs if I have the same questions or something. I found that like through social media, through TikTok, that was a way that I made a couple friends. But yeah, that's those are the two that I would recommend.
Nice. Anything to add, Grace? Or are we pretty much sums it up, right?
Yeah, I've also seen a lot of events, especially like people say call it like design Twitter. I've seen a lot of events like Twitter, TikTok, I need to get into TikTok more, and Instagram as well. And I've seen people like post like Instagram stories, Instagram feeds. So on LinkedIn as well. So like LinkedIn, Instagram, TikTok, Twitter are also other places and newsletters as well. I just subscribe to like almost everything and filter it that way. And that's how I like keep my tabs open and everything.
Nice. Okay. Well, there y'all have it. Some cool places where you can find out more about design-a-thons and events and where to connect with the community. And speaking of social media, Grace, Kate, it's time to go behind the scenes on the amazing projects that they have worked on using Creative Cloud Express. So first up, we have Kate. And can you go do a little intro about what you're about to show everyone today?
Yes. So just a bit of context, I'm going to be creating a mood board / vision board that I would use to craft my personal brand. And a mood board is usually like a collection of visual inspiration. It could be colors, images, text, photos, anything that you want that encompasses who you are and what kind of message you want to put out into the world. And this is what I used to do back when I was job searching. And it was a great way to kind of not only guide the creative process of designing my logo, my portfolio, resume, but it also served as an inspiration point where when I was going through the job search to remind myself of what I was working towards, which sounds really cheesy, but that's the point of a mood board, to be cheesy and inspirational. So let's just jump into the demo.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm starting from scratch here. There's a lot of really great templates on Express for mood boards, but I just prefer to start it from the ground up. And then I'm gonna adjust the background color. I want it to be like a light neutral beige color because I like earthy tones. And then I'm gonna drop in a headshot of myself or an illustration that I made of myself in this case. Then I'm gonna use the text tool to write myself a header. You could write your name, your title, even the title that you're trying to work towards in the future. And I'm gonna change the color using the eyedropper tool as well to match my shirt. And I'm also gonna change the typeface to something a bit more funky, more playful. I really like the current trend of like 60s, 70s bubble lettering. So I'm gonna do that. And then also adjust it as a curve over my head to make it more playful. And then I'm just gonna move that over to the side so I can start dropping in all my other elements. And I also want my mood board to have like a scrapbook, informal feeling. So I'm gonna go to the design assets and find some photo frames that I like. I like these instant photo frames. So I'm gonna drop in a couple of these and just adjust the size placement to how I like it. And there's really no rule to how you want this to look. It's all based on your preference. So maybe it's more helpful for you to drop in different typefaces, color palettes, more tangible things that can help you to create your brand identity. Or you might go about it in the way that I am and treat it sort of like a fun collage of your interests and goals. So here I am, I'm just adjusting these frames. And then I'm gonna go and drop in a couple of photos that describe me. I have this example of a staircase that uses like organic shapes, pastel, earthy colors, basically a design style that I personally like. And then one of my personally favorite parts of the design process is UI and visual design. So I have an example of a game that I designed with my friend where we incorporated a lot of animation and illustration. And then one of my goals is also to become more active in the design community. So here's an image of design buddies. And I am also part of a content creation group with my friends called Designers. I would really love to continue the work that we're doing on Designers and then also hopefully create some content of my own in the future, like videos, articles, and publish it online. So that's one of my long-term goals. So I'm gonna put that on there. And now you can see me just adjust the photos so that it would fit into the frames. I want it to look like it's a real Polaroid photo. So just cropping it a little bit. And then I'm gonna drag the layers of these images down so that it's underneath the frames. And this part takes me some time because I'm doing it individually. So once that's done, I am gonna write down like kind of the interest goals that I just mentioned in text form. Just to double down a little bit more on the messaging that I'm trying to get across, I'm gonna choose a new typeface, a nice sans serif, scale it, and then adjust the placement of it so that it kind of hovers over each photo. I also wanna note that if this was a real mood board that I would use right now, I would probably add in way more content than just 5 photos and really sit down and think about how I want to communicate myself. Usually to kick off a mood board like this, I would ask myself questions like, who am I right now? What do I want to become? What unique values or skills do I provide? And what kind of visual style describes my personality? What do I like subjectively like? And then I would decide what visual elements I want to populate this with. So I'm just putting in my last text note here. This part is also slow. Just adjusting it below my picture. And then lastly, just to give my mood board a nice visual kick, I want it to look scrapbooky, like I said. So I'm dropping in this white paper texture. And then I'm gonna adjust it to fit the whole canvas. And then I'm also gonna change the opacity of it so that I can still see everything. I'm still scaling here. So once that's done, I'm gonna change the layer to multiply, reduce the opacity so that it's kind of transparent. And then I'm gonna move it to the bottom of all the layers so my images still pop out into the foreground. This is a really super simple way that you could get started with your own mood board as well. and start thinking about your personal brand in a more fun visual way.
That was great. That was great, Kate. Oh my gosh. I loved the mood board idea. I also loved how you approach the mood board with like the Polaroids, the backgrounds and all that stuff. And this illustration is so cute. And where did you make this illustration? In Illustrator or?
Yes, Illustrator.
Nice. So as you can see, you can incorporate elements from like if you made something on Illustrator or Photoshop and bring it in to Creative Cloud Express and then make some cute graphics just like this. And so, yeah, thank you so much for the demo, Kate, and which leads us into Grace's demo.
Yeah, awesome. Yes. So today I will be showing over how to use a carousel. So I decided to kind of create my own template on this. I created a 3-slide carousel, and I'll talk about more about carousel design. And these are just like fun posts you can do on social media. And fun fact, at least since algorithms change pretty often, but at least right now, carousels increase more, like the algorithms on like LinkedIn and Instagram like carousels because people spend more time on it. And if you spend more time on the post, then LinkedIn and Instagram will like boost your post to more people. And that's like low-key why I chose carousel as well. But I also wanted to test out different Express features when I was doing it and try to like create my own template with the features available. So I'll be using specifically libraries where you can upload your own photos. They can also be from like Photoshop, Illustrator, as well as saving them as templates. We can play.
Okay. Let's go for it.
Yeah. So I'm creating an Instagram post template. And over here, I've also pre-uploaded stuff for my library, which can be created on other design tools like Illustrator, Photoshop, and for our topic today who is Fluffle Carousel. So you'll find out more about Fluffle. This has not been posted on our social media yet, but will be soon ahead of our second birthday coming up next weekend. So we're giving a little more context. Who is Fluffle? So I have a title here introducing what the topic of the carousel is. And then I'm just duplicating the text by clicking Alt drag. It's an easy way to duplicate a lot of text. And then changing the font weight. I also uploaded my own font. I can upload like extra font. So I uploaded Poppins, which is with our brand guidelines. And then I also dragged in a blob here, which can also be created in other vector tools like Illustrator. And drop them in here as well. Added a little fluffle here, which I drew, and more blobs. And then later on, these are all in my library. So if I create more posts, they will also appear there as well. And so more blobs, because I like blobs and they're very fun organic shapes. Let me know in the chat if you also like blobs as well. They're a very fun tool to use. They bring a lot of more dimension. I also have speckles, so I uploaded my speckles in here as well. And these are just like part of our Design Buddies branding. It's more playful and it's like a toy box a little bit, and just like adds more like flavor or like spice. We like to say it, we spice things up, so that's why the sprinkles are there, or speckles. Sprinkles, speckles, or confetti, however you want to call them, which we'll also have another fluffle fun fact later on too. So have swipe for more in there because you want to encourage the user who is viewing it to swipe. And right now what I'm doing is I'm saving it as a template, which I can later save as a template and then make a new one with the same exact template. So if I want swipe for more in every single other carousel I make, it will already be there. So I'll maybe make a total of three different templates. So I can also access my templates from the library. And here are our pre-made three of them. But for this one, I decided to create another template. So I'm going in and this is a new file. So I can move the blob so I don't have to like remake everything because it's already saved as a template. And I'm moving them a little bit and deleting some text and introducing Fluffle. That's how Fluffle came by. Fluffle, in actual English definitions, means a group of bunnies. And the reason why we chose the name Fluffle is we're a community, so it's a group of people, but bunnies, and Fluffle represents all of us. And so that's how Fluffle's name came from. And it's just really fun to say. It has like a nice little ring to it. And so yeah, Fluffle represents all of us. And I'm also rearranging my speckles a little bit here, rearranging or deleting some of my blobs, having swipe for more. And then in the content page of my carousel, sometimes I have my Instagram handle on there for Design Buddies. And then I also have another one, which I'm just like duplicating them or like alt clicking, dragging them. And then I have swipe for more or save for later. The reason why I have it there is because on Instagram, the save button is over there below. So it just have something to prompt the user to do. And then over here, I'm just adding more fluffles to the mix from my illustrations. I just added to the library, and I'm reusing some of the blobs I have here from the first carousel I have. Also rearranging some of the layers, which is pretty cool. I don't have to like click like alt like bracket. I can just like go to the layers and rearrange everything right there. So I love how visual it is as well when I'm rearranging a bunch of images together. And then I have fluffle and just rearranging, making some minor tweaks with each other as well, and have been fluffle hanging out together. Adding more speckles, sprinkles, confettis to, you know, spice things up, give it a little bit more spice and flavor. I guess like brand flavoring to design buddies. And yeah, more confettis and just tweaking them around so they look a little bit different each and they look organic. And here we have our second carousel. So I'll save it. Oh, I'm rearranging little minor tweaks, saving it as a template. And then I will later be duplicating this as well. I just named it Fluffle Template 2. Let me save it. This is also done on times 2 speed. So normally it took me about 13 minutes. So I'm speeding through a little bit, but it's actually pretty quick that it only took me 13 minutes to make 3 total slides, saving it as a template and stuff. So here I'm making my third slide, and this is introducing a little bit more about who Fluffle is, what makes Fluffle special. So I showcase superpowers. So what superpowers does Fluffle have? And then I'm just reusing some of the text I have from the other template, and I have Fluffle here as a bullet point. Later on, we'll drag it there. Fluffle can shapeshift. Fluffle can become anything you want. We like to have Fluffle as diverse as possible. So Fluffle can like vibe with many people. That's what Fluffle, one of the superpowers is, it can shapeshift into anything. And you'll see this very soon. Fluffle has many different forms. So I have one bullet point. So I'm just clicking both the two and duplicating them to make 3 rows of 3 different superpowers. I'm editing the text. Fluffle is very wholesome. It can cheer anyone up and is the life of the party. So we later have Fluffle with confetti. That's a third fact. Fluffle comes with confetti, which is what you see with all the sprinkles you see in the background, because Fluffle is just likes confetti and colorful things. I'm just rearranging them so they look nice. Sometimes I spend too long arranging these things. I'm sure y'all.
Same.
That's what I'm doing here. And yeah, adding another blob here. This time using the blob with more fluffles in here. Rearranging the open layers so my text appears there. And I don't, because I'm using a template, I didn't have to recreate any of the text there. For all my carousels, I have Fluffle as a scientist and Fluffle with confetti. And rearranging them as well. And then adding some fun shapes because Fluffle comes with confetti and we want to make sure we see it all on the carousel. And then, yeah, there's Fluffle with confetti and I save it and voila. And then I can save them as a template and use these for any other carousel I want if I want to introduce someone else or have like design content.
Oh my goodness. That was so much fun. Both of your demos were so well. And honestly, it just blows my mind to see how easy it is to just create all of these things in Creative Cloud Express. Y'all did it super fast, even though it was 2 times the speed, Grace. Honestly, sometimes that's how fast people work. And when you said 13 minutes, I was like, that is still incredibly fast. And I think you displayed how you can use the Pro Tools as well as Creative Cloud Express seamlessly. Oh my gosh, I cannot talk today. Seamlessly with the use of Creative Cloud Library. So thank you so much for that. Those were amazing demos. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, so we have so many people in chat talking about it. Camille says Fluffle is the vibe. Yes to diversity. So dope. Mix is so dope. Fiona says awesome. So people definitely love the demos. All right, so we are almost at the end of this event, unfortunately, but we do have one more question. And this will be the last question of the night. Again, we are having a Discord after party, so we didn't get to a lot of questions today, but remember, you can ask them in the Discord after party after this event. So stay tuned for that. So last question that I like to end off a lot of these events on is, if folks were to take one important thing away from the stream, AKA your last piece of advice, what would it be?
Do you want me to go first, Grace, or do you want to go?
Yeah, you can go first. I'm thinking which one to say.
Okay. So my advice is something that I was told back when I was doing my job search as well. And it was to present and articulate yourself that you would a piece of design work. So basically, since good design is built by more than just subjective opinions, I tried my best to always remove my doubts and my own insecurities about my skill sets and be very honest and kind of emotionally removed about the way that I assessed my strengths and weaknesses. And that helped me like really understand who I was, what I should be emphasizing in my interviews, and how people like recruiters could be perceiving me as well. And then I would do research. I would research companies that I applied to by thinking of them as somebody with an unmet need. So if they're hiring for this role, what kind of qualities are they looking for and how can I meet it? And if I didn't really get the answers that I was looking for in the job description, if it was too vague or not as helpful, I would do more research by kind of stalking the designers from that company to get an understanding of what they like and how they contribute to the design role online. And I don't mean stalking in the literal sense, but just like searching them up online, seeing what they're doing, what kind of communities they're involved in. And then I would just go back to my self-assessment, come up with a story, basically kind of like a value proposition of myself, and then present it as I have this quality, this XYZ quality. You as a company are looking for XYZ qualities. So if I get this job, I could bring that value to your company. And I think that framework for self-awareness went a really long way. So that would be my advice.
Nice.
Yeah, definitely plus 1,000 to self-awareness. And the advice I like to give is don't be afraid to try new things. And how this looks like is like what stopped me from trying a lot of things when I was younger, especially is the fear of judgment from those of so-called like higher in authority. So this would look like professors and stuff. So I've always like was interested in design, but was always told like you should stick with your major, blah, blah, blah. And like just don't be afraid to like not listen to them because it's your life. And yeah, you're going to be with yourself for the longest time. And if you do the thing that makes you the most happy, then you'll end up being more happier in the long run as well, and being most likely more successful. And also like don't take everything too seriously and like stress out, because I used to get like so stressed out about things, especially like interviews and stuff. And instead of like, because I would fear failure, instead of seeing it as a failure, like I didn't get the job, I would see it as like a learning opportunity. And so if I didn't get something, then I would ask, oh, what went wrong? Like, how can I improve next time? And see it as data. And that leads me into like UXing your job process, because I used to have a lot of ego. Like I used to think like I was the best. And then I got deeply humbled by a lot of situations. And now I see things as like just data. If it doesn't work out, then like I learn from it. I learn why. And I use it to make better decisions next time, or more informed decisions next time. And just like UX the job process and it keep iterating your strategy. So this means like A-B testing your messages, A-B testing your portfolio, and just like getting feedback. I don't know. I just view life that way as just like a lot of opportunities to like test things out and just being open-minded to seeing whatever happens and using data to like make informed decisions. And with the data I receive, like I'm more confident in decisions in life. So yeah, don't be afraid to try new things, be open-minded, and everything's a learning opportunity, even though it might suck in a moment. Like failing, being rejected sucks. Accept it and treat it as a learning opportunity. And that's personally what helped me keep moving forward.
Boom. There it is. That's just mic drop right there. Y'all dropped some such amazing advice. Janice says, very much true. Roberto says, their words really helped bring in a new perspective. Nusa says, 100% fear of what people think. So definitely, I think a lot of us took so many gems away from this talk. And I just want to thank you all so much for taking the time out and chatting with the community today. I'm sure I can speak for everyone in chat that we really all appreciate you too for being here and sharing your knowledge with us. So let's talk about that giveaway. Okay, so we have a couple, not just three, we have a couple fun remixable templates made with Creative Cloud Express. And we want to know, all three of us, everyone, the whole team wants to know what your dream job title would be 5 years from now. And we're going to manifest it. We're going to put it out into the universe, and we're going to put it on LinkedIn. So here is what we're going to do. With the link dropped in chat here, it's going to take you to a library of templates right here. Feel free to use them or don't. Make your own. Doesn't matter. So we have a couple different variations right here. We'll just select one and it'll just open up the project. Give it a minute. It is going to load, and then boom, it pops up on the screen. You'll get this message. Just hit continue without brand. Totally fine. It's just the branding that we put behind this event. So you'll still be able to work from the template. So here we have my dream job title is super simple. Where it says job title here, you just gotta change it up. My dream job title honestly is content creator. And I love that. So we're just going to adjust that. Feel free to change the font, change the size, make it big, add some funky effects to it, whatever you wanna do. And then we have a picture here, so we're going to feel free to replace it with a headshot or a photo of you that you love. So all you have to do is just click on the photo, hit replace, and then we're going to pull in from my Lightroom, but you can upload a photo, pull from Adobe Stock, really anything. Oh my gosh, I'm exposing all my photos in my Lightroom, which is fine. I do it all the time on Adobe Live, so it's cool. So we're just going to grab a photo. This one looks promising, and then it is just going to go ahead and remove the background automatically, and we're just going to make it bigger so you can see my face. Yay. And then once you're happy with the look, let's move this over a bit. It's fine. It does not have to be perfect at all. Then we're going to hit download, download it as a PNG, and then you can post it on the LinkedIn and use the hashtag Adobe Dream Job and hashtag Express It for a chance to be randomly selected for a one-on-one mentoring session with Kate and Grace. And also let us know the first steps and how you plan on achieving your dream title. So we just want to know, you know, what your dreams are, how you plan on getting there. And also bonus points if you also post the design or the link in the challenge submissions channel in the Creative Career Discord server, our team will be able to see all the awesome work that you have made there. Okay, so speaking of Discord, again, we'll be having an after party. I feel like I mentioned that like five times today. Well, we're having an after party in the Creative Career Discord server where you can hang out with Grace, Kate, and myself, ask more questions. And if you can't make it to the after party, no worries. You can connect with us on social. And also we'd love to hear your feedback on this event so that we can make it better for you in the future. So please take a moment to fill out our post-event survey. The link will be dropped in chat. And all right, so with that said, that wraps it up for this session. So thank you all so much for joining, and thank you so much Grace and Kate for joining us this evening. And yeah, we will see you all in the Discord. All right.
Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Thanks,
this was
everyone.
Fun.
Yes, this was so fun. All right. Bye, everybody.